So it's day 12 of fasting. I went 24 hours without food today because we did go out for food again like we did last week in the countryside. So it takes a little while to travel there. You've got shower, change and things like that. And today I really want to cover, because I obviously talked about the fact that the fasting isn't just about my habits and everything else. It's also about how I'm feeling, what I'm experiencing. I'm doing this for a lot more reasons than many people would do fasting, perhaps. It's not just about emptying, losing weight or, there's a lot more to it than that. And one of the things that I've noticed right from day one, and just before I started fasting, actually, was synchronicities and number manifestations. And these have always puzzled a lot of us, and none of us really know what the actual true answer is. But I'm getting very close. I can feel it because the universe is talking to me. The universe is communicating back with me every time I make a suggestion or do anything that's that's along those lines. Like when I get a right answer in my head, the universe will throw a synchronicity at me or a number manifestation, and I'll go, ah, that's the route I'm going down, and I would go down that route because I've already been prompted. And this is how I follow it. I just follow what happens. And where is that taking me now? Where is that synchronicity taking me at this moment? What has it taught me? What was I thinking at that moment when that number appeared again? What was I thinking? What was I doing just before? And this brings me on to one of the fantastic things I haven't covered up to date on these on fasting, my fasting videos. But 2 days before I started fasting, I started getting a number of manifestations, and it was the 11-11 again, and it was the usual. I get everything with 11 at the end, so it's 9-11. 3-11. They're the two main 11s, and that whether that's AM or PM. 3:33. I don't get that one so much anymore, nor 2:22. But I definitely get all the 11s. So it'd be 10:11. It would be 2:11. It's just ridiculous. It's 5:11. So 17:11, 3:11, and 11:11, 9:11 are the ones that I mainly get. But you sort of you get a bit used to seeing that, if you know what I mean. Because before I started fasting, I found that when I first seen the 11:11 was when I said I'm going to do this fasting. It was something I was been planning to do, but I sort of never really had time to think about it. And I realized in a couple of days' time, it's in my star sign, and I said I wanted to go all the way through my star sign. I picked my star sign for just the reason that it's my star sign. It may be that our star signs are not actually our star signs. It may be that who's to say that our soul doesn't go into the body when at birth, which would make it 3 months after my actual birth date when I would be in my star sign. But to look into all that can be quite confusing. Is our star sign when the day we're born, or is it the day where actually the egg starts to form into a human? These are many questions, and to be honest with you, it wouldn't make no difference to the star signs itself, in my opinion, because we align traits to people who are born on that time. But we would have to readjust those if we realized it was 3 months later and it was actually at the point at which we were conceived that that this magic happened, and that was our star sign. We would still have to take the traits of those star signs and put them into that area. Do you see what I mean? It might change the planet alignments and things like that, which obviously have an effect on human beings. That's obvious. But so what I'm basically saying is it doesn't make no difference to the telling of your fortune, to your life traits. It wouldn't make any difference to that. It would just make a difference to alignments and actually where your true alignments are. Is your star sign sort of 3 months after when you were born? So not wanting to dwell on that too much, but that's just one thing. This is how I think. I'm thinking all the time, and I'm going through all the scenarios. But going back to the 11:11, when I thought to myself, I need to start my fasting in a couple of days' time, I seen 11:11. And you don't think much of it. There was a time when I would have typed it all over the internet and said, I just saw 11:11 again, amazing, because it was really shocking. But now I just see it as a sort of alignment. It's an alignment with nature, with the universe. And when you get these numbers, I tend to follow them. What was I thinking at that point? What was I actually thinking about? Because whatever I was thinking about was a trail I've got to follow. A bit like breadcrumbs, a lot like the synchronicities that we get. I mean, number manifestations are sort of synchronicities in a way. And then a few days after I was into my fasting, I was going to bed. And as I got up off the toilet to walk across the land to go to bed, I listened to audiobooks. So I got my phone out. You know, it's quite weird living in the country. You listen to owls, and then you move into the city, and you've got people talking outside. It's quite hard to, you know, not get up and have a look outside, see what's going on, because you're not used to it. So I put an audiobook on, you know, sort of mid volume, and just fall asleep to that. Quite relaxing, actually. And just let it play out, whatever it wants to do. And you know, I pull the phone out of my pocket, and I'm thinking all these thoughts, like, you know, and then I pull the phone out of my pocket to see the audio button. There it is, 11:11. And I just think, oh, 11:11, all is right with the world, you know, and then I go to bed. Because that's a great way to go to sleep, to plant into your subconscious mind and sleep on overnight. You know, a third of your lives is spent sleeping, so you must do a very good self-suggestion before you go to sleep. But there's some things beyond that that happen during these number manifestations and synchronicities. And one of the things that happened to me last night, for instance, that ends up being million. These things end up being millions to one. I can tell you they're not. This is not. I don't believe in. What can I say? What was the word I was trying to find? I don't believe in it that much. I forgot it. But, coincidence. I don't believe in coincidence. I don't think that's a word that is I need in my life. I just believe in synchronicity. Everything's a synchronicity. Everything has a purpose. And, you know, last night, for instance, when I was waiting for my last night's video to upload, I had my phone down by the Wi-Fi, so you've got to leave it on YouTube to be able to upload it. And I picked up my wife's iPad because I saw somebody on the other day playing a little video game, one of those old Astro Wars games where you've got to sort of shoot the aliens with your little ship at the bottom and they come down and swirl around. I remember playing on it as a child. And I started playing that. And I realised after losing my life twice on that game, that it gave me a lot of anxiety. My heart was racing. I didn't feel so good. I didn't feel so good about the world around me. And at that moment, I sort of thought to myself, is this game destroying my connectivity? Because this is part of the reason why intuition, that you sort of connect with the ether, is all these funny things go on where you're actually, your body's not in any state of trauma or digestion, you know, digesting food all the time and all these things. So when you're eating more pure, you get these real high alertness, high awareness of everything around you. And one of the things that I noticed was immediately after that, and I thought, don't make me feel good. I'm going to put that down now on the arm of the chair. I'm not interested in that. I don't play video games, you know, I'm not interested. I've never been one to sit down for hours on end in front of a games console. I just won't do it. I'm not saying they're not entertaining, they are, but I've never really enjoyed it as much as some people do. Some people spend their whole lives on there, and that's up to them. But when I actually did this, this is the sort of synchronicity I'm on about, and it's millions to one, you know. I went over, I found my phone, it uploaded the video, and before I even had a chance to share the video, I picked up my phone and it uploaded the video. So I went back onto YouTube itself on my home thing, and it gives you suggested videos. And the very first video at the very top of the list was, it was something like this: does computer games destroy our connectivity to the universe? And I was just like, or connectivity to God, they might have said, or whatever, you know, something like that, whatever description you give the universe. And I was like, wow, what are the chances of thinking that 2 seconds earlier when my phone's over there, and then coming out and picking up the, I mean, I'm up by myself at this stage. I'm on my own. I'm making that clear because I didn't say anything out loud. It's not like the mobile phone or the, you know, we all know that there's a desire in certain groups of individuals around the world to tap our algorithms of our voice to make suggestions on our so-called smart for them, smartphones and smart TVs and everything else. But I never suggested this. I never spoke it. I thought it. I thought that question, and the same question come up in the title of the video, the very first video on the top of the list of the YouTube channel I was on. And I'm just like, these are the things, this is the way your life goes. Like when you've got this connectivity, you think things and the answers present themselves. And you go, ah, now I see. You get guided. You get guided by numbers. You get guided by synchronicities all the time. If you look hard enough, you'll see them all the time. Even when you're not so connected, you will always see these synchronicities, but they particularly come strong when you're living in alignment with nature. And when I got that, it was like, wow. So I had to watch it then. I'm not going to go and share my today's video on Facebook. I've got to watch this first. So I watched the video, and then it was about children in a third world country, Africa. And they were bought a games console, a PlayStation 1. Because they're, you know, that to them would be the creme de la creme. To us, it's old hat. We're on like number 4 or whatever it is now. But you know, to them it was everything, and they kept asking for this PlayStation 1. And they got it, and they had it a whole year. And the guy who bought them it said to them, Why do you not ask me for it? What's wrong? Why, you know, you really wanted this, and you've played on it twice in a year. Like, what's the reason? And they said that the children said out of their own mouths that they didn't, it disconnected them. It made them not feel very good. And they said it. They said disconnected, specifically, or something along those lines, ruined their connection. Their feeling. It took it all away as soon as they played on that game. So these children are very, you know, aware. They're very aware of what's going on around them. And we sort of get indoctrinated out of that as adults as we get older and older, if we buy into thought processes and systems too much. But it just amazed me that there it is. There's your answer. Don't play on the video games. You had the thought. You decided that, you know, you had that thought of, hang on a minute, this is not making me feel very good. It's giving me anxiety, which is, you know, fear-based. So it started me questioning. Then I got the video with the answer instantly. I watched that immediately, the moment I'd asked that question in my head. And there was the video to support my answer. And I watched that and thought, right, that's it for me for video games. I will never play them again. Not that I played them very often anyway. But this is the sort of thing that happens. That's millions to one. If I went onto YouTube, which is huge, and I put in those video games can destroy our connectivity with nature or whatever, with the connection, I doubt that would come up that often. And I've never searched that. So it wouldn't come up as a suggestion because of past searches. Because I've never searched that. I've never even searched our connection with the universe or anything. So we can't even put it down to the algorithms of what I typed into search. I very rarely search videos. If I did, I would probably put in some kind of rallying. You know, I love WRC rally and things like that. But other than that, I wouldn't bother. And, you know, so it's things like that. Now, people who don't get that, I've got no problem with people who don't get the synchronicities and they don't get the number manifestations. And in actual fact, a lot of people got slated when the 11/11 was really strong a couple of years ago, when everybody was seeing it all the time and it was all over social media that everybody had seen this phenomenon. And you know, it was amazing to witness. But there were people out there who would do like smart ass answers, because they didn't get it, because they didn't get that connection. They would give little you know, smart ass answers like, just switch your clock off. That's it, problem solved, you know, no more problem. It was like it was a problem. It wasn't a problem. It was just amazing that you can't see that many times that number. Because for people like us who see these number manifestations, what really fascinates me about this, and all the 9/11 and the 333 and the 311, 311, 9/11, and God, and 1711, so 511, basically, very, very common. You know, very common. And 11/11, obviously, the obvious one, 10/11. But it was all the 11s, but they were the main ones all the time. It was like obsessive. And you could say, then you get the people who argue, and rightly so, they would say, well, when you're scanning a room, you would look around a room, there could be loads of digits everywhere, but your eye would be immediately drawn to 11/11. Now, I took that on board, and I thought about that in my life. Now, remember that I'm working on at the time I was working on an extension, and there was no electrics on yet. There was nothing. So we were literally running from extension leads, and, and that was that. And we're working away. It's normal sort of site work. Now, there's no numbers anywhere to look at. There's nothing. Nobody really wears a... I don't think anybody wears a watch to work. It's quite dangerous anyway for certain things, but nobody wears a watch. But I have a phone in my pocket with the time. So of course you're going to get asked the time and things like that. Now, I thought to myself, because I'm not one to follow time. I don't, it's just there. It's just convenient for appointments with other people, things like that. But apart from that, I wouldn't follow my own personal life. I wouldn't go, oh, it's time for a cup of tea now. It's like, 10:30 a.m. or something. I'm not like that. I just feel how I feel and I respond. So what was amazing was that every now and again you pick out, just see if it's AM or PM, because when you're self-employed, it doesn't matter that much to you time, but you do want to see, how am I doing with this work? Have I got enough time in the day to start this job and things like that? So I picked the phone out of my pocket and there it is, 11/11. So that's the first time that I've looked at my phone, apart from the time when probably I left my front door. And there it is, 11/11. So you think, okay, there you are. It's a game, day after day, but here it is again, another day, 11/11. And then I suggest to, at the time actually, it was my dad. And I don't know what it is, it's really strange, but I see 11/11 all the time. And I also see 11/33 and 3/33. They were the most common ones, the 3/22 as well, but I didn't mention that one at the time. They were the most common ones at that time. And that was like, that was quite amazing. And anyway, so I thought no more of it, 11/11, put it back in my pocket. So 20 odd minutes later, just by chance, my dad come back and he said, fancy stopping for a cup of tea? What's the time? And I picked the phone out of my pocket and I turned around to him. I said, it's 11:33, look. And his eyes just went, because I told him this earlier on. I said, no matter what I do, this is when I look at the time, all the time. Now, when that happens, and you've now interacted with someone else and it happens as well, still, what this says a lot of things to me, because if you didn't know better, you could say to yourself that somewhere in your, I just looked at the time on there, and it's 19:11 on the minutes. You could say to yourself, you could say to yourself, well, what it is, somewhere in your subconscious or your unconscious mind, there is a prompt, there's something inside of you that knows what the time is. It knows what the time is, and because you've put that request out, you pick your phone out of your pocket at that time to check it, because it's what you've expected, it's what you've, your desire in the morning, your words, your I am statements, which a lot of you who follow me on social media know is very important. Your I am statements are, I always see 11:11. So you put that suggestion out to the universe, and all of a sudden you get prompted because you're in your inner self, which knows everything. You know that the time when there is 11:11, it's time to look at it so that you can get your daily manifestation of 11:11. And you look at that, and you can put that down to that. But what really fascinates me is the fact that that wasn't. This is millions to one, because those of you who get it, you know that it happens all the time. It goes through stages. When you seem to be in alignment, it's just everywhere, all the time. And, you know, and then to, what fascinates me is the fact that there was an interaction there now. So not only did I put the personal desire out to see, you know, by my I am statements, I am always seeing 11:11, I'm always seeing 11:33, blah, blah, blah. Now what I've done is I've now manipulated someone else's actions around me to ask me the time, to prompt me to pull my phone out of my pocket again when I normally wouldn't, because I don't follow time that closely. I wouldn't look at my phone every 20 minutes. I might look at my phone twice a day, maybe three at a push if I just check in right on the evening before I go, because I've got no need. I've got no need to. There's no time limits or anything. So for someone else to ask me again, and then see that I've, you know, it's almost like I've interacted with them. I've now, with between us, we have put a desire to for 11:33, and that person has fulfilled that role for me, because they've instead of me prompting myself and me putting it out of my pocket, I'm now showing them that they've asked me, and now it's 11:33. There it is. I can't manipulate that time. I can't set it. It's just the iPhone thing, and you know, it is what it is, if you know what I mean. So this becomes really weird, and then the next time that day that I look at my things in the afternoon, and that was 3:33, and you just think, wow, you know, this is way beyond anything, way beyond anything. Incidentally enough, just a few days after that, I've seen lights coming up from different coloured lights, almost like electromagnetic lights that you get, but in columns coming up on my way home through the countryside, beautiful countryside, lakes and all that sort of stuff. And it was there for about 6 seconds and it just vanished. But I've seen it coming up as bright as day, at night, you know, in sort of twilight time. It was going up in columns like laser beams coming up from the ground. It's just amazing things you see, and you just think, wow. And I, you know, you burst out into tears, actually. You can get so emotional with these numbers and seeing electromagnetic beams of light coming up from the planet and things like that. You know, I was crying so much I couldn't pull over, because I was in country lanes. So, you know, you can't, it's dangerous to pull over anywhere on a country lane. There's hardly any lay-bys, you know. But you just got to keep driving, dry your tears away, and just think what a wonderful universe. And that's the way this all goes on. So my understanding of the synchronicities and the number of manifestations, what they mean to me, and what seems to keep them flowing really strong, is to pay attention to exactly what I was doing or thinking at that moment. When I see the numbers, when I see the synchronicities to what, like I was saying with the video games, that was the universe's way of telling me the answer to my question. Immediately, in almost real time. It was literally straight after I chucked that down and asked myself that question, walked over, picked it up, switched it on to YouTube Home, and there it was, as a suggestion. And it was almost exactly the same time. So I then played that, because you have to. If you get a synchronicity like that, those of you who get them, you know that those synchronicities are very important. And I played that, and what I learned from that was, absolutely yes, here are children. So now I've communicated, if you think about it on a bigger sense, I've communicated with children under 10 years old, or just over 10 years old, in an African country, who in an African third world part of the part of the continent. And I've then had them answer my question indirectly through social media. How amazing is that? You know, This is the sort of stuff I talk about, and sometimes these things can be so strong. I've had things when my granddad was alive in this very house, because this is my nan and granddad's house. I love them to bits. The best people in my life, I can tell you that. Without them, I wouldn't be who I am. But I was here with my granddad after my nan died, and there was some really funny. There was such an event of synchronicities, and yeah, it was mainly just synchronicities, not so much the number manifestations, that I actually started to look around me and think, am I the only person here? Is everything else just acting from me? Am I the only person to observe everything around me that's going on? And am I actually building this? Have I connected on such a deep level that I'm almost lifetime creating my reality at every single step? So everything everybody said, I knew what they were going to say. The radio played a song that I thought about in my head just before it had played. And this wasn't because it was on as a little clip to show what was on next. It just come on. And I was sat there going, this is weird. Like, my granddad spoke to me. He was actually not too far before he died. He spoke to me and all these strange, with all these answers, and he actually listening to me, because all people can be quite stubborn. And he had cancer, and I wanted him to go down the natural route, but I would never push anybody. Even if I see them, go to their end of life, it's a personal decision. Who are any of us to push any natural therapies or whatever? We can just make suggestions and try and encourage them. And if they say no, not interested, I think the doctor's got it right and the oncologist knows better, then that's fine. So that's fine, no problem. And you have to, unfortunately, we have to watch them fade away. But when I was speaking to my granddad this particular time, he was actually asking me questions. And he never did this. Very stubborn man, very, very knowledgeable, very clever, but very stubborn as well. He was asking me questions, and actually, when someone's really listening to your answers? And it was like he was having a realization. I almost felt like he'd had an awakening, because I don't think some people necessarily get in their whole life. But maybe he had like an awakening just before, not long before he died. And then as soon as I did that, I thought of a song, and the song came on the radio. And then the weirdest, and this is where it gets really strange, is because if people I know from Facebook, I shared a video, which I thought about quite a lot that actual morning, and how schools kill creativity. Schooling, The word schooling to me means a school of fish, all thinking alike, following each other around, in endless circles. That's what schooling means to me. This is all sensor fasting, by the way. You get videos. That was a random video that was just shared with me by someone who don't very often share videos, and just said, look at this. Didn't even say anything, just shared the link. And you think, yeah, that's just come at the right time too. And all the things that I think, And and then there was this guy who did a video on how schools kill creativity, and I thought it would certainly never be covered on TV, because the things that are talked about in it are basically anti the whole system of schooling, and how it warps, and how scientists are basically see themselves as just lumps of meat with a brain sat on top, and the lump of meat that exists all below the brain is what keeps the brain going in order to do their scientific research. And he was going on about this, and you think to yourself, well, this is really sort of alternative thinking. And now I walked into the front room after this, coming back to like this video, because I quite like little videos like that. There's a lot of humour in there. And I walked back into the front room of my granddad's immediately after that, where he had the TV on. And on the TV, just as I walked in, because I don't watch TV anymore, look, so I'm not going to get any synchronicity through television unless I go into someone else's house. And as I walked into the front room, up pops this bloke. And a segment from his thing, and he'd been interviewed on the morning time TV, whatever it's called now. And then the segments come. No, that was it. That was it. I shown the video to my granddad of that, and I played it to him, and I said, "Look at this, granddad. You know, this is what I'm on about." You know, with because I respected him a lot, but I knew he was old school, so he was quite closed minded. But he said, "No, do you know what? Actually, I think he's right." And he was like opening up that morning. It was really strange, you know, asking me questions, really looking for the answers. He watched this video and he sat down and watched the whole 20 minutes clip or whatever it was, 22 minutes. And then I went into the front room and there was this video that I just played being shown to on morning TV, and the bloke who made it is being interviewed. And I'm like, can there be many more things? And I said, "Granddad, come in here." And he couldn't walk too well at that moment. "Granddad, come in here, look at this. Would you believe that?" I said, "Look who's on the TV." He said, "God, that's the guy you just showed me on a thing with the same clip." It was the same clip as on the TV as I showed him on the table just moments before. And I said, "Yeah, that's really strange, isn't it?" He said, "Yeah, what a funny coincidence," because obviously I'd never seen him as being, you know, aware, like on a bigger level. Albeit intelligent and everything else, I'd never seen him being aware. He was quite factory minded, if you know what I mean. Government got your best interests at heart, you know, and all this sort of stuff. Now, but to him it was a coincidence. To me, it was such a run of fantastic synchronicities that was going on all around me. And I started to think, because the question he was asking me was prompting my mind to think down different paths as well. So I started to think that he's providing me with the questions that I need to research next. The song's providing me with the lyrics of, you know, what is going on around me. And the TV is providing me immediately after showing the video on there. The TV is providing me with that same bit of video as if to say, you're right, schools do kill creativity, you're dead on the right track, and here's your little sign for you. And that was the most amazing. I'll never forget that. I'll never forget those moments. This is the sort of run of synchronicities that you know, that I speak of, that you actually start to doubt that there is anything or anybody else in the universe. That's what I thought for a while. And I now think different. I've thought through all this. This is going to be a long one tonight, but I'm really feeling connected. And the conclusion I come to is that there's a whole entire planet full of people who all have individual choice, who all have individual sovereignty, and every single person on this planet can choose to do exactly what they want to do. And the way they choose to experience or do things in life is through your own self-suggestion. The questions you ask in your head, the light-hearted suggestions that you make to do with what's going to happen next in your life and how things are going to pan out. Because remember, it's self-suggestion. I don't like referring back to the Bible and things like that, but there's many other forms of this available. It's not just, you know, to look in a Bible and find these sorts of things, but at first there was the Word. And when you think about things like that, the Word wouldn't be what you're actually physically speaking. The Word isn't what it's spelt like and how you say it, or even the actual frequency. The Word is not the frequency the Word spoke at. It's not the language it spoke in. It's not the way it's spelt or drawn out. And it's not the way you speak it, apart from the fact the feelings. But I'm going to get onto that now. The word that they talk about, at first there was the Word, is that you have to have a way to describe something around you that doesn't exist or do exist in order to create the feeling within your mind, within your imagination, in order to create. Do you see where I'm going with this? So in the English language, for instance, if you add the word bad, so if I said that's really bad, then that would mean in the English language that it's horrible, it's dreadful, it's not very good, basically. Now, if I was to turn around to you and say then, oh, that's bad, that is, and people around me could see what I was referring to, they would instantly know that bad meant good. So bad can mean bad and good. It can mean both things. It's personal perception. So if I were to say that's bad and mean bad as in horrible, I would be tuning into that frequency. I would look at that. I would feel that. I would imagine what I'm seeing. And I would feel that into existence and into my body. If I was to turn around and say, that's bad, that is, you know, as in good, which is sort of a saying that came out, you know, in the 80s, when they changed bad to mean good, this word is bad. It's really confusing, the English language. There's loads of words there, loads. It's a load of rubbish, really. There's also words that are spelt the same and look the same and everything else, but they mean two different things. It's crazy language. But yeah, then if I said that was bad as in good, that would create a different frequency within me and a different thought process. And that thought process, your feelings, your that you tune into, because remember, when you're thinking of a picture, the picturing power of the mind, that's creating a feeling within you. Like when you wake up from a nightmare and you're having a nightmare and you wake up and your heart's pounding and you feel that was so real until you wake up here. And then you realise that was just an alternate reality and now I'm back in this one, so I'm safe again. You have to be careful these things don't bleed through from one reality to the other if you're experiencing bad things in your dreams. And you have to try and tune out of it. And this is where, you know, magic comes into things, because when you're tuning into alternate realities through, or when you're making self-suggestion with words, it's not the words, it's the feeling, it's the frequency you create, it's the picturing power of the mind that connects with a frequency. Every single thought, every picture you can put into your imagination, everything you think about and you picture, you know, when I could sit here now with my eyes open and I could think of someone's face and I could picture their face in my mind at the same time as I got my eyes open observing the five sense reality. But the picturing of their, I could be in daydream land here with my eyes open, but picture their face and go away with my feelings to them and feel what I wanted to feel to do with them. And that would be the frequency creator. And every single picture you make in your mind with your imagination, every single picture carries with it its own unique frequency. You've just tuned, it can't be measured. It can't be measured at the moment by science or anything else. But it's like an electromagnetic frequency in a different energy level than we can actually get to a set of gauges out. And you can't measure it with volts and amps and everything else. It just exists. At the moment, it's unseen. You can feel it. You can feel people's intentions towards you, for instance, because you can feel the way that their frequency of their mind is, if you're connected. Like I am at the moment, I can feel if someone doesn't like me or if they do like me. I can even feel what they're going to say to me just by feeling what they're doing next to me. I can be like, they're going to ask me that. I'm going to reply this, da 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 da. And that, we're designed to feel that. We can feel what other people are thinking, you know. Sometimes with the handshake, I think there's people out there who can shake a hand and pass thoughts. So this is the way that I perceive the world. You know, there are people out there who say, let's shake a business deal. And they just go like that, and it means nothing to them. Oh, well, what I'm supposed to do, you know, they're told what they're supposed to do, grab the hand tight, you know, make sure it's a meaningful shake, you know, don't let go too soon, all this sort of stuff when you're doing business deals. And that's all rubbish. I truly believe that there are people out there who can hold the hand like that and shake someone's hand. Because I get this on a minor level, not on a big level, but on a minor level. You shake someone's hand, and as you shake, there's an awareness of this is good, this is bad, and all the other thoughts that go flooding through your mind at the point of contact with that skin from right hand to right hand. And that's what some people rely on to make their business decisions, just a handshake. Do you see what I'm getting at here? It's a frequency, it's something that we can't measure yet. But every time we picture something in our mind, with our imagination, it then has no choice but to, you know, if we're desiring it and we know it to be true, and when we know it to be true, we feel it in here and in our guts. You know what he say about gut feelings? You know, your guts is, you know, loads of bacteria, basically, you know, I think it's 90%, is it, of your immune system is in your gut, which we kill off in our normal daily lives by drinking alcohol and flooding it with God knows what that we put in there all the time, but that's another story. You know, if your gut feelings are anything to go by, we always know that whatever's going to become our reality is already felt by the guts. Now remember that we're microbiotics. We are basically, essentially, a load of little planetary systems. You know, we've got the nucleus in the middle, like our sun, and then around that is the protons and neutrons, and that's like all our planets that are flying around. Perhaps we're a proton because we're alive, and perhaps all the rest of the planets at the moment are neutrons. Who knows? It's just you know, just throwing ideals out there. But basically, we're loads of tiny universes. When you keep breaking life down, you can't get to the minimum substance. You want the, this is what drives me mad with people who. Scientists who say they want to look for the God particle, the bit that's very small. Well, that's how you perceive to be small. The person who's living on that nucleus within that atom that we're built of, trillions of them, the person who's living on board that, they see that as being a huge universe. And they would see all the atoms that make them up. So there's no end, just because we can't perceive smallness. It doesn't mean to say that every time you go to a planet and you get that planet and you zoom into it, it doesn't mean to say that there isn't then another planet. And then there's people living on that, or organisms, and then you zoom into them, and then there's another bunch of planets. And you can just keep going on forever. Whilst you can never reach the end of the universe, because there's no wall. If there's a brick wall, then there's got to be something beyond the brick wall. It never ends. It gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Just the same as it gets bigger and bigger, it also gets smaller and smaller. So as much as these scientists, you know, they're thinking in factual ways, five-sense reality, which is what all scientists operate from. It's just a five-sense reality, you know, that's it. And they keep looking for the smallest particle that they're able at this moment to focus in on from the size that they are, considering they're huge in comparison to an atom. And as soon as they manage to tune in on that, they may see other things going on in that little universe. And then those people that are on that little universe and organisms then perceive the ones to be below them as being, you know, the smallest parts, and don't even perceive anything any bigger, because the amount of atoms that it takes to make us up makes us pretty much, you know, are we ruled by... If we're tuning our hearts in and our gut feelings and everything else, we're basically calling up every organ, every part of our body that we're actually made of, all these miniature planets, all these miniature balls of energy. And it already knows. It's like, if you know something to be true, if you can actually switch off to the five-sense reality and know something to be true, it will become true, because there's no doubt in my mind that each one of us create our own realities. Now, it doesn't mean to say that we don't interact with each other, that we're all totally independent and we're the only people that exist. You know, each one of us are the only people that exist on this planet, because we're not. What actually happens is you don't interact with anybody else or anything else around you in the planet if that's not what you imagine or perceive or actually make part of your reality and your desire. Because remember that I've lived a very troubled life, you know, there's been much tragedy in my life, and I could turn around and blame that exterior. Believe me, no one would want more than me to believe that I was a victim of something else, and it wasn't me who brought all this bad luck to me. But I'm afraid that I, in my, you know, you go by your own thoughts on this, and I'll say fair play to you if that's what you feel. That's fine, there's no problem. But my own personal beliefs now, after all the things that have happened to me, and all the evidence that I've seen in my own personal life, is that I've created my entire life. Because from the moment that I watched my brother get ran over and his head was facing backwards and all these horrible thoughts, you know, his bone was sticking out of his leg, you know, I didn't even know people died at that age, at 9 years old. And there's my younger brother, completely, nearly every bone broke in his body. You know, his skull was shattered, his spine was shattered, he had broken arms, broken legs, it was everything. And I feel that I have my innocence taken away from me, and I was tuned into trauma at a very young age. And I believe I never really stepped out of that. I went into a downhill spiral of trauma, and because I was picturing, the picturing power of the mind would always see that bad things were going to happen, because now I know that people die, and I'd look around and I would be keep on imagining bad things happening. You know, I ended up with a life of torment. And then you start saying to yourself, these things always happen to me. Why does everything always happen to me? Da 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 da. I'm not feeling this, by the way, while I'm saying it, just so you know, because I know how this works. Why does all these things happen to me? Why does you know, why do I get all the bad luck? And I must have been a bad person in another life, and all this sort of stuff you tell yourself when you're going through all this. You're creating a self. A perpetual downhill spiral for yourself. And you know that this, let's say that I put a desire for something. Let's say that I started thinking really badly, like, my car may get broken into tonight or whatever, and I started really feeling that. Somebody, because I've put that out into the ether as a light suggestion, and then like, no, and I've just gone on and gone to bed or whatever. As a light suggestion in my head, because I've put that out, somebody somewhere who has the desire to earn a little bit of money or even go out and break the law would then feel compelled to walk wherever, from wherever they are, or drive from wherever they are, and see my van, for instance, and decide to break into it. So my nature has given me what my self-suggestion has done. This happens to me all the time, by the way. So, you know, it's something you tune into. You can't take total control of all of it all the time, but you can certainly manipulate, you know, at least 50% of it, at least. You know, and I'm getting better. I'm getting better. And the desire within me. Because it wasn't a desire. It was a desire because I thought of it. I pictured it in my mind. I brought it into existence and I pushed it out there as a suggestion to the universe. And the universe would then find the nearest person to fulfill that desire for me. So everybody who interacts with me on a daily basis, whether it be on Facebook, which by the way is a reflection of self. I've always said this. People say that, oh, that Facebook is just terrible. It's nothing but hassle, nothing but arguments on there, nothing but this, nothing but that. I'm afraid it's a suggestion. It's a reflection of self. So it is what you expect, and it is what you desire. It is what you push out into there, whether you like it or not. You may think that you don't like it, but you're the one who's suggesting it. You're the one who's thinking it. You're the one who's putting it into the ether and picturing it in your mind and feeling it, and feeling it. Because how easy is it for us to? It would be absolutely so easy for me to tune into the fact that something tragic happens in my life because I've had so much tragedy happen. So it's very easy to me imagine someone dying in my family. It's very easy to me for me to and feel it. This is what I'm talking about, the feelings. It's very easy for me to feel completely flat, broke, poor, as in, not in, you know, in terms of connectivity, but in terms of financial, you know, digits on the new age computer screens and all that sort of stuff. So it's very easy for me to feel poor, like I haven't got enough money to get by, because that's predominantly what people like ourselves have always been through. We've always been through that sort of poverty. So it's so easy to tune back into, because it's a pre-existing state that we just hop back into what we're already in. How difficult is it for us to turn around and tell ourselves that, we have no money worries, that things get paid when they need to get paid on time, and that's the way it is. It's very hard to suggest that, or even suggest that we've got more money, say, than we need, because we don't know what that feels like. But for a billionaire and for a millionaire, people who are born into money, they're born into money. They're told right from a child that they've got no worries about money. Your dad's a billionaire. He's going to take care of you. Your mum's a billionaire. They're going to take care of you. You'll always have what you want. You'll always be left money. You'll always be bailed out. And I will always, you know, because my parents are billionaires, I will always be a billionaire. Now, what ends up happening is, yes, they're a billionaire. They don't lose that money because they don't know what it feels like to lose that money. They're billionaires. And that's what they tune into. They see everybody else around them as being, you know, servants to them. And guess what? Everybody ends up being servants to them. Because it's easy. They've already tuned into it. They already see that and feel it to be true within them, because that's what they've been born and bred into. And what we're witnessing now around the planet, which is remarkable, is the fact that we are actually starting to... These people aren't connected, by the way. They're not connected. They don't get the way all this works. They just feel... It's just easy for them to feel rich because everybody else is rich. It's easy for them to feel corrupt because everybody else around them is corrupt, and be able to get millions of pounds and get away with it. So that's easy for them. They're not connected. So what we're witnessing now is their inability to connect and realize consciously what they're actually doing to keep their riches is now flipping. So what you're seeing is a moment in history now where these people are starting to tune into the fact that maybe we're on a bit of a rebellion here. There's 7.5 billion people around the planet. We could never control all these people if they all decided to stand up together. What if people just don't buy into it anymore and they go into self-sustainable living and they just stop paying their taxes and stop buying into all of our rubbish that we control them with? And they're starting to have doubts. And this is where we're seeing the reality change. This is how you can predict events happening. Because I've seen something. I've seen something in... I hate to mention his name, that horrible piece of work. But, David Cameron, the first time he tried to go into Syria, I actually posted about it. I look back through my posts sometimes just to see what was going on back then. Now I perceive it all now. And when David Cameron first wanted to go into Syria, and the desire of all the people was like, no, we've had enough. You're not taking us into another endless war. I'm sorry, but that's that. And everything else that happened, the MPs voted against him. Now, he didn't expect that. That was a remarkable moment for me. I must look it back up, because I can remember thinking at the time, I haven't watched this since, I can remember seeing the vote read out live at the time. And I can remember him standing up, and he had nothing to say. He had this great big pile of paperwork, and he stood in the House of Commons. And it came out that he was actually voted against, so he couldn't go into Syria. And he's got this ready to go, right, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, and we're going to bomb them and bomb the hell out of these lovely innocent children and everything else in the name of freedom and democracy, you know, and all this rubbish. And when he actually stood up there, he said, I coincide to the democracy and I respect the rule of democracy. And that was it. That's all he had to say. And he sat back down. And it was a moment, because it's the moment of the look on his face. The look on his face and the fact that he had to say those words and he couldn't fulfill what obviously he's been paid to do and given backhanders to do. Because he couldn't go and bomb the shit out of all these innocent people, he was devastated. And obviously it come about, and then a year later they were back in it again. So they just play it all out again and see if there's enough desire within the people again to, you know, they just keep going. That's how they do it. They keep going and going and working away. But when you look at what's going on now, you're seeing primal fear in all, nearly all billionaires, people who are, not just people who are rich, but people who are famous as well, very famous. You know, you're seeing primal fear in celebrities. It's almost like to get where they are, that they've had to join some sort of club, and now all of a sudden they realise that, you know, this club that's coerced them into doing bad things in order to get into it. A bit like a gang in America that would say, well, in order to be in our gang, you've got to go and do a drive-by shooting of somebody, and then you're initiated because we know that you're willing to put yourself in prison for life to be within this, be loyal to this gang. And it's a bit like that with the celebrities, I think, that there's a primal fear there. And it's hard to try and figure out what that primal fear is. It's easy to go down the child torture and child molestation route, and that would probably be the most favourite, but because it's very easy to control someone if you've tempted them with children and maybe into some sort of sacrifice, or even brought them into it as a sort of a bit of a shock in innocence, and they've witnessed it and they haven't said anything about it. It's easy to get some sort of secret camera set up there and hold these people to ransom. And they've got to play along this line, and they have to make songs that suit this, and they have to be in these films and play this character. And now they have to stand up on stage and say that they're going to, you know, commit violence because they didn't get their own way in a democratic vote or something like that, you know. But you see primal fear in all of them. And almost they're their own little circle. A bit like President Snow's... you know, when you look on the Hunger Games and you look at President Snow, and I always say this, what you've actually got going on here is an elitist group of people who've got fake everything. You know, just like on President Snow's, you know, fake hair, fake eyelashes, fake nails, fake boobs, fake Botox in their face and everything. You know, and then you've got the likes of us who are just average everyday people who are going around working class, trying to earn a day-by-day living, which is fantastic. A lot better than being a celebrity, believe me. It's not always cracked up to be. I'd sooner have be an average Joe like this and make these videos and get about 10 people watching it and really excited to watch it than ever be some sort of poster man or something, you know, or some sort of figurehead or something like that. I would hate that. I'd like to be unrecognised. And just seen for being an inspiration to a few. And you know, when you look at all this with what's going on with the celebrities and how it relates to the Hunger Games, and how you see that there's almost a separation where the celebrities, President Snow's Hunger Games population, who are very rich and live on a rich side of town, everything's very sterile, all square buildings, square windows, nothing natural, you know, and it's all sectioned off from the rest of society, and they don't actually even get, they're almost victims of their own upbringing and their own group, because it's all self-gratifying all the time, and they become in their own little circle, and that little circle is very very tight-knit, to the point where they just don't get anybody outside of that. They just don't get the way of life that they exist outside of that. And then you've got the likes of us who are really sort of connected. We go for walks through the woods randomly. We can walk around and speak to people. We're happy to communicate with all types of people from all, you know, from millionaires right down to, you know, tramps on the street. We're the most aware, by the way, in a lot of cases. And yeah, it's very... It's very strange how you can see these things playing out, and you can see the way that things play out in society, and you know that things are gonna happen because you see the fear raising in those people in positions of power. So remember that. Remember that we've got them on the run, you know, and they don't know. They're not connected enough. They never will be. They've been brought up unconnected, but used as sort of a tool. So they're not connected. So as long as we keep studying all this and taking care of our inner thoughts and desires and making sure that our self-talk, we're not planting hate or wish this person would die or, I wish harm on people around us, but actually just connect with nature. The more we do that, the better that life is for us, because we're just bringing that into our reality. So I'm going to end it there, and I've really enjoyed this one. I've really, really enjoyed this because I'm sharing a lot of things that I've been thinking about for years, and I've been trying to find ways to describe everything that you've got within, because you can think things and you can have this greater awareness and everything else, but it's hard to articulate into words where we can all listen. We can all sit down and listen to a video like this and interact with it. And if you're watching this, and you're on my Facebook page, which is my Facebook wall, if you've got access to that, then please, comment on the video and just put your 2 pence in, because it's so interesting to listen to whatever the people think and what they feel about what's going on. That's how you learn, that's how you grow, There's so many aware people out there, it's unreal. It's absolutely fantastic time to be alive, a fantastic time. And if you're somebody just randomly watching this on YouTube, then please, I go on Facebook and type in Kai Bowman.